Hello learners, welcome again to Manifested E-Learning Platform. Today I would like us to finalize the tax planning topic with the areas that remained. So we covered some areas like evaluation of job offers, and today I'd like us to look at the remaining subtopics. So the major topics still we are at tax planning, and there are some subtopics that remained which I would like us now to finalize. The subtopic number one is tax avoidance. And avoidance provisions or measures. The other subtopic that remained is uses of tax incentives. The other one was disposal of a business operation and restructuring activities. We also had says a special economic zones, special economic zones act, and the last one we had tax risks. So let's start with the first part, that is tax avoidance and avoidance measures. Tax avoidance and anti-avoidance measures. And when we talk about tax avoidance, what do we really mean? Tax avoidance is a legal way of reducing the tax burden. It's a professional way of minimizing the tax burden. That is, reducing the tax burden without violating tax rules and regulations. And therefore, if the taxpayer engages in tax avoidance, he cannot be penalized by KRA because that one is a legal practice. Tax avoidance techniques include, for instance, taking advantage of capital allowances. When you are calculating, for instance, the taxable profit, you can calculate capital allowances, you treat it as an allowable deduction, therefore you end up reducing the taxable profit and tax liability. Again, still, for instance, somebody may want to finance his business, maybe as a manager. So you can finance your business either through equity or through debt capital. So a manager can opt to finance his business through debt capital because he will be required to pay interest, and that interest is allowable when calculating the taxable profit, therefore paying again less tax. Another example is manufacturers. Manufacturers, as a manufacturer, one can manufacture goods for export or for local consumption. If one manufactures goods for export, then exports are zero rated. So VAT is charged at 0%. These are for exporters. But if you are producing goods for local consumption, then you are charged VAT at a standard rate of 16%. So, again, somebody can do avoidance by manufacturing goods for export so that one may not be paying VAT. But for local, you will be required to pay VAT at a standard rate of 16%. Then, again, we have anti-avoidance measures. And avoidance measures means a situation whereby somebody can engage in tax avoidance technique, but the commissioner say to such transactions. This is covered under Section 23 of the Income Tax Act, and it states that not all transactions are acceptable as tax avoidance techniques. There are two major cases that we can discuss here, which the commissioner can reject such particular transactions. For instance, if we have like a director in a given company who buys a car from that particular company at a throwaway price, and that car was bought, it was captured in a given class, maybe for the purpose of calculating the capital allowances, it was included there. Then the director opted to buy it at a throwaway price. So if it is bought at a throwaway price, we subtract that value when calculating the capital allowances. And as you remember, the way we calculate capital allowances, we have classes like class 1, class 2, class 3, all the way up to class 4. So if it is like motor vehicle, it was bought and it captured like maybe a lorry in class 1. Maybe it was bought for like a price of like 20 million. Then after 1 year, the director buy that particular asset at a price of like 1 million. And therefore, I'd like you to see, for the purpose of calculating the capital allowance, we less the selling price. And therefore, what will be subtracted is 1 million. We included 20 million, we less now 1 million. And therefore, because this car now is disposed, we will leave figures in the computation of capital allowances like 19 million. We continue to claim for capital allowances, but this asset is not existing. And therefore, that now make the commissioner to reject such a given transaction. Another example is like if maybe we can have a child who is employed like in a company, and this particular child, maybe the company is owned by the parents, but the child is getting very, very high salary. And as you know, it is not possible for the commissioner to enter into a contract with a minor of paying tax. And therefore, if we have a scenario whereby this child is getting very high income, but she's not paying tax, the commissioner will reject such a transaction. And therefore, such a salary, the commissioner will not allow such an expense which is salary to be treated as an allowable expense. The commissioner will either say that salary be treated as disallowable or that income be taxed on the parents. So that is how, those are some of the cases whereby the commissioner can reject some of the tax avoidance practices. And again, for in case of the director buying a car, so the commissioner, the direction that the commissioner take is, the commissioner will come up with a view that what is subtracted here as the disposal value when calculating the capital price, the capital allowances, what is supposed to be deducted is the market value of that particular lorry, but not the selling price like we normally do when we are calculating the capital allowances. So maybe after 1 year, like this particular lorry that we captured in class 1 is likely to have a value of like 18 million. And therefore, when we less that, we will not be claiming capital allowances and the asset is not existing. So that is what maybe we need to understand under tax avoidance and tax avoidance measures. Number two, we have tax incentives. Tax incentives. We have uses of tax incentives. But first of all, it's good we know what are tax incentives. A tax incentive is an incentive that is granted by the government or KRA to persons or to taxpayers in order to encourage them to continue to pay tax or to attract new taxpayers to the tax system. Remember, we cannot survive with the current revenue that we are generating. The government need to keep on generating more revenue. And as you know, the government expenditures tend to increase day and again. And therefore, we need to come up with a way of increasing this particular revenue. And one technique is by introducing tax incentives. When we give these incentives, we tend to attract people and or to motivate those people who are paying, and therefore the government is able to raise more and more revenue. Examples of tax incentives, they are like, for instance, taking advantage of capital allowances, like investment deduction for normal manufacturing, or maybe like wear and tear, maybe allowances. We also have personal reliefs, double taxation relief, claiming for input VAT. Those are some of the tax incentives techniques. But now, what are some of the uses? Why do you think the government grant tax incentives to its people? The government grant tax incentives to its people, number one, maybe to attract uses. We can give them to attract investors. To attract investors. Remember, we have both local and international investors. And therefore, when we give tax incentives like capital allowances, for instance, investment deduction, we tend to attract investors, and therefore, when they invest, the government tend to raise more and more revenue. We also give tax incentives to motivate existing taxpayers. In order to motivate the existing taxpayers, those people who are paying tax. Remember, paying tax is painful. It pinches. And therefore, we need to motivate the taxpayers. And therefore, through tax incentives like capital allowances, e.g. wear and tear allowance, where somebody is using his assets to generate taxable income. If you appreciate loss of value of that particular asset, then to some extent, that particular taxpayer feels demotivated and he continue to pay tax. We also give tax incentives in order to discourage tax evasion. Discourage tax evasion. Discourage tax evasion. Remember, some people feel that the government is taxing them in order for the government just to benefit. So tax incentives are also given to discourage people from engaging in tax evasion, because the moment you are given this incentive, then you tend to focus more on the government. You tend to see that this is your government, and you develop a positive attitude on the same. Therefore, you are motivated, and it can make you to continue also to pay tax. Also, tax incentives helps to improve tax compliance. So remember, when you give me an incentive, then I feel motivated, and therefore the tax compliance level again tend to increase, which is very, very important in countries, because the moment people are complying, then it means that the government tend to raise the adequate amount of tax. The other one is, we also give tax incentive in order to increase future incomes. So you'll find that in future, we expect the government expenditures will increase. So we need to introduce tax incentives today so that we can motivate people, we can attract people, and therefore in future, we are likely to find that the revenue is likely to be a bit high. And the last thing is, we also give tax incentives in order to make taxpayers develop positive attitudes. positive attitude. So we don't want taxpayers to develop a negative attitude towards the government. And therefore, we need to ensure that they have a positive attitude by granting them with the tax incentives. At least they see that this government is caring for us. And therefore, tax incentives can help in changing the negative psychology that people tend to have. At least we make sure that our taxpayers have a positive attitude towards our government. Then we also need to look at the disposal of a business operation. And the restructuring activities there are some instances whereby a business can be disposed as a going concern. For instance, we can have maybe a trader who has registered with the VAT and another person also who is registered who is willing to buy that particular business. And KRI can accept a sale of that particular business without charging VAT. Remember, when goods exchange hands or when sales takes place, we are supposed to charge VAT. But there are some cases whereby KRI accept disposal of business operation without charging VAT, especially where the two persons have registered and the business is being exchanged as a going concern. But for this to be accepted by KRI, there are some things that need to be met within 30 days. The seller need to disclose some information to KRA within 30 days. For instance, the details of those particular transactions should be disclosed to KRA, that is within 30 days. So in that particular case, KRA can accept such without charging VAT. You also need to inform the commissioner how the overdue taxes are supposed to be paid, because the moment the business is operating, it may not have paid maybe all the taxes on time, and therefore to some extent the tax that has not been paid, the commissioner may want to know how that tax is supposed to be paid. So that also has to be made very, very clear so that that transaction can also be around. The commissioner also will be interested to know the value of taxable goods of that particular business which is being exchanged. So like the value of stock and all that. So the details also need to be provided. And the last one, the details on how or on the person who will be maintaining the records, especially during that particular period. There are some cases where, in that case, the records have to be maintained. Like we know when you are doing business, records like invoices, cash book, and all that. So we don't want to have a gap in the process in this particular transaction. So it has to be made very, very clear to the commissioner who will be maintaining the records so that we can ensure that no information will miss in the process of doing that particular transaction. And if all that is met, then the commissioner will accept sale of that particular business as a going concern without charging VAT. Then we also have special economic zones, Act. And the Special Economic Zones Act is an act that was implemented by our government in order to encourage or to attract investors. In this particular case, special economic zones are zones that are created or that are set aside by the government so that we can ensure that we empower the investors in that particular area. So they act more of tax incentives because there are some benefits that are enjoyed by investors of special economic zones. So this particular act was established so that it can support these particular areas, and what they are doing, it can also remain legal. There are some benefits that are enjoyed by these particular economic zones, like there is element of tax exemption. You'll find that maybe in these particular areas there is no payment of tax, or if there is payment of tax, tax is paid at a lower rate. So either tax exemption or reduced tax rates. So taxes are paid at a lower rate. So in that particular case, therefore, we tend to empower those people who have invested in such zones. The other thing is there is also another benefit that they enjoy, like we have work permits, whereby you find that those investors who are working, who have invested there, they are provided with work permits such that they can carry their business with a lot of freedom. And again, also there is a benefit that is enjoyed, which is a protection of property, eh? Those like intellectual properties, real properties and such, those people who have invested there, again, they enjoy such. And maybe also we have capital allowances, eh? Special capital allowances. This is meant to ensure that we motivate those people who are operating in that particular area. We can also maybe highlight some examples of the types of SPE. That is types of special economic zones. Types of special economic zones. So, like for instance, the country like Kenya, we have a number of special economic zones, including, for instance, agricultural zones. And these agricultural zones, they are meant to ensure that the agricultural sector is improved. And again, we can attract many people in farming, so that at least we can boost the production of food in our country. Again, we have number two, free zone port. These are located at the port, and they affect the matters of import and export. We have also free trade port. Again, it is also established to boost the matters of trade on the same. We also have ICT park, Information Communication Technology Park. And this one is meant to improve the ICT sector to ensure that we attract many investors in IT programs. We also have recreation zones or park. And again, this one is meant to ensure that we boost our tourist industry or recreation industry, and to some extent the government also will be guaranteed of more future revenue. So those are some of the types of special economic zones. So we can finalize with the tax risks, and when we talk about tax risk, this simply means the risk that the taxpayers or the persons may not comply with the tax system. The chance that we have taxpayers, we have persons, they know that they are supposed to pay tax, but there is a chance that they may not comply with that. What are some of the effects of that? If the members of the general public fails to comply with the tax system, then obviously the government will miss the tax revenue. The other thing that you note also, public services may not be offered, like public schools, public hospitals, and again, such. We also have development. So it means if people fail to pay tax again, the development obviously has to reduce. So tax risk in most cases can be attributed maybe by the attitude of the persons towards the government or the psychology of the persons. If they have a positive attitude towards the government, then the risk goes down because obviously chances of complying they are high. But if they have a negative attitude, those people may not comply with the system, and therefore the tax risk increases. So that marks the end of our session. But as I conclude, we agreed that for every class we need to be having some revision questions. So I will see one or two questions that we can use for the purpose of revision. Like for instance, I have this question from our revision partner, that is May 2017 question 4A. The question reads like this: describe three tax planning opportunities that could be derived from financial management decisions in a company. Describe three tax planning opportunities that could be derived from financial management decision in a company. So when the managers are making decisions, so which are some of the tax planning techniques that can be exercised, and we end up maybe reducing the tax without violating tax rules and regulation. Again, I can read another one. May 2015, question 1A. In the context of tax avoidance schemes, describe how firms might employ the following approaches to avoid tax. Approach number one, bankruptcy or liquidity of a firm. How can you reduce tax or avoid tax in case of bankruptcy or liquidity of a firm? Outsourcing services instead of employing permanent staffs. Number three, purchasing fixed assets instead of leasing the assets. So we need to see you trying to identify those particular tax avoidance techniques in these particular cases, which may not subject somebody to penalties and fines. We have many questions here, so I would like you to attempt all of them. And after you have finished, maybe you can check some solutions at the back of this particular book. We have come to the end, and thank you very much for choosing to study with us, and I hope to meet you in the next session. Thank you.